My name is Anil Arora. I'm a part of SAS analytics practice team. Background-wise, I have been part of Accenture, Infosys, with SAS. So I've been working on predictive modeling right from my, probably from day one on my jobs. With SAS, I am predominantly assigned for my responsibilities really around the AI/ML practice of SAS. So we are helping our customers in getting onto AI/ML journey. How do they get onto that AI/ML journey using SAS, you know, platforms? Now, just one request for all of you. We have been circulating a notebook in the audience where we just need your registration IDs. So that in this, in case there are any questions that come up and we want to get in touch back with you, we'll have the details with you. So in the meanwhile, we'll be just circulating the notebooks. Okay. Yeah, I know it's going to be tough for you guys at 5:30 p.m. in the evening and still being able to attending heavy doses of AI/ML. But I promise you to make it more interesting, more worthwhile for you to be sitting late in the evening on Thursday. Right. So first of all, thank you everyone for coming here and for such a great event. I think I have been attending a couple of sessions since morning. I really found those to be interesting. I always thought there's so much of to learn from everyone, and I really realized that today. Now, before I really start, you know, on the modeling topic that I have chosen for today is essentially building and deploying machine learning models with an open SAS platform. Yes, I'm calling it as a SAS open. It's not an open SAS software, it's an open platform. And the reason I say it's an open platform will I highlight in my next, you know, few slides. Okay, so before we start on how do you build and deploy machine learning models, I'm just going to very quickly cover up on how really you know what's the analytics life cycle is, how do we go about building different phases of building a machine learning models and finally deploying them in downstream applications. A very high level flow. I think the first and the foremost step of building any machine learning model, classical machine learning models, statistical models, even a deep learning model, the first step that you need really is a data to really work upon, right? And now you're getting data from not just a structured databases. Traditionally, that's what, you know, we have been working on. We are getting data in the form of text, images, videos. So that really forms the engine for you to build any machine learning model or any statistical model. The second, of course, step is the pre-modeling steps. Now, this is where a lot of the scrubbing of the data really takes place, right? You will do all kind of descriptive analytics, just see what's the completeness of the data, what is the availability of the data. Remember the philosophy, right? Garbage in, garbage out. So it's our responsibility, our practitioner responsibility to really make sure that the fuel that you are putting in to make your machine learning models work is really not a garbage, because you give in garbage, you take out the garbage. So it's very important to really have your data cleansed as much as possible for you to be able to build any kind of a machine learning or a deep learning model. Third step, modeling. I think this is where people do get start interested about, you know, building, as you know, people still call that, this is where really the magic works. Now, you could build, you know, n number of models. You could even iterate number of models with just one equation, with just one algorithm. But, you know, the ultimate goal is to really build a model where you can define your own champion models and your challenger models. So be it a case of identifying a spam versus a non-spam emails, be it a case of any classification models, any prediction models, any forecasting models, this is where the, you know, the modeling is really happening with the different algorithms now being available for us. The fourth stage, post-modeling steps. Again, a very important part of building any predictive models, right? You could build multiple iterations, as I said, with different algorithms, even with a single algorithm. So personally, I have also built using a one algorithm and running around 50 odd techniques on the same algorithm. So this is where I was getting a bit greedy in terms of how do I really build a model which is the best that possibly can be used by my business. So at times, it's good to get greedy in terms of really identifying what is the best iteration of a model, But yes, there are time constraints that we generally run upon, right? So to really build a model and to identify which is my best model, you do a lot of validation statistics that you really need to work upon, and then you really decide upon which is your champion and a challenger model, which really gets consumed in your either downstream applications or in a manual. Still, some of the people are still using those manual ways of, you know, extracting the codes, extracting the, you know, algorithms, pulling it back manually into their downstream application. But there are newer things that have really come up, which I'm going to talk about and possibly try to show a demo around it also. Last, not the least, but unfortunately the least spoken about and the least talked about, because people still consider the magic is here, so why do we have to worry about all these steps, right? To really complete the analytics life cycle, you need the deployment aspects to be very strong. Right, you could build n number of sophisticated models using all those AI, ML, deep learning techniques, neural networks, CNN, RNN, YOLO version V1, YOLO version V2. But if they are not getting deployed, they are really a piece of paper lying in a bin, right? It's all the efforts that you have put up till here, right? This becomes more of an educational exercise rather than your business getting benefited from the efforts that you have put in over here, right? So it is very, very important you build models which are really deployable, and there are a number of reasons why your models don't get deployed. Couple of them could be, you know, the model is not in sync with what the business expects. So I built a model in my previous organization, and we statistically, I mean, very few people could come and, you know, ask me, you know, this model really doesn't work statistically. I was very confident of building that model and gave it to my client. But the client came back to me that I can't accept this model. I was taken aback, like, what's happening? The client said, the variables that you have in your model, I cannot do a classification based on the industry that you have taken as one of the important variables of building a model. Because as per the regulations of that country, they cannot use that variable to differentiate on making any outcomes or any predictions. So this is where my whole exercise of building a model went for a toss. And I had to rebuild that model again. That gave me a learning that whenever you build a model, always go and build that model which can easily be consumed also. So you need to have that business sense along with being a really a data scientist who can work really deep down on those algorithms. This is where I personally feel the whole personality of a data scientist really comes in. You just don't really have to be a very good person who can build models with the available algorithms that are available, because building a model is using an equation, or now we have, you know, tools that have come up which have made our life much easier in terms of building models. So that is not really, you know, that is a good part, but not really the most challenging part. So we need to have a full-fledged view of building and deploying the models. Okay. I'm going to cover up a couple of topics, picking up a couple of topics from this whole cycle. One is the feature engineering. I think this is more of a public demand that, you know, somebody asked me that, can I cover enough feature engineering? So I'm covering that. Plus, I'm covering up interpreting the machine learning models. How can we interpret those models, machine learning models? Because typically, not long ago, people were saying, you know, the machine learning models are not really interpretable. So I'm going to talk a bit on it. Then we'll jump on a very quick demo of building a machine learning model and then deploying it. Let's get deeper. Feature engineering. The feature is really a synonym of an input variable. Like the inputs you call it as a feature, right? Now, finding best set of inputs to be used in modeling is really about identifying those parameters. This really forms the crux of building or scrubbing or getting the best data for your modeling purposes. Typically happens at a stage of data and preparation in your, you know, the complete analytics life cycle. Why is this really an important, right? Because when you get the data from your data warehouses, it's really, you know, in the form the way a business has been running at the back end. So that's the variables those gets captured. You need to and you can make a lot of variables for you to be able to have a better prediction of the models. Now, either the data is available in your, you know, existing data set that you get from your data warehouses, or the other process could be you could build newer variables, which could be any transformations of those variables or any kind of, you know, engineering that you would do on the existing variables. Whatever the way of building or making a feature engineering, the end goal is really to build a model which generalizes well on an unseen data when the model was getting built. So that's the essence of how do you really, you know, do a feature engineering. Now, there's a concept called curse of feature engineering, because as you would have, you know, realized, I'm talking a lot on creating newer variables. High dimensional data is everywhere, right? And we create more. We keep on creating some more variables around it. Now what happens is, now we are getting data, you know, in a high dimensional space from everywhere. What's happening is when you, you know, you are getting more features on your existing data sets, the observation set that is there, if that remains stagnant, the sparsity of this feature space in that observation space is really increasing, is probably increases exponentially. So as your data, as your observation space, you know, doesn't grow, your feature space increases, right? The problem of model not getting generalized to a new data set increases. That is where this concept is called as the curse of feature engineering, the curse of getting more variables. That is called a curse of dimensionality. There's a reason you do feature engineering, but then you always get a curse of this because your feature space grows and your observation space doesn't grow. So you need to realize how much feature engineering really needs to be carried out and how much you really need to cut down upon the redundant variables probably. Now how do we take care of this curse? What actions can we perform while building a machine learning models? So what does this include? The four processes I'm at a very high level I'm just talk about. One is constructing new features. Constructing new feature is really akin to like, you know, preparing a data from the existing data sets that you have. Now this could be a logarithmic transformations, this could be, you know, inverse transformations, this could be an autoencoders, this could be level encoding, or this could be creating variables from the existing, you know, variables. It could be deriving variables from the existing one. For example, you are given a date, you know, I think people somewhere from the banks also. You get a date of a birth of a customer, you get, you know, when did a person bought a policy from an insurance company. You create those variables, right? You create the tenure of a customer with a particular organization. So all those stuff, this aspect is really you're creating newer variables. So that's predominantly forms a part of my constructing new variables. The second is selecting only key features, right? You could end up having, you know, 200 or 300 odd variables, but if I can select probably around 70 or 80 variables out of those 100, which is explaining the same variance that has been explained by my overall data set that I have, I really don't have to pick up every single variable of the 200 feature space. And because if I'm able to explain the variance that has been explained for my dependent variable or whatever I'm going to predict, is what really I want those features, right? I don't really need every single feature of what's being presented to me. That's one way of reducing multicollinearity. That's one way of reducing or getting to some really important variables. I'm not calling it as significant variables because it's more of a statistical term which really comes into a model building process. The other is, okay, the good part is selecting key features really helps you preserve the interpretability of the variables, because there's no newer variable gets created with an orthogonal component. It's not a PCA, but it's essentially picking up those same variables. So you don't lose the interpretability of the variables that you have, which makes you much more comfortable in explaining the models to the business, because you don't have a newer variable which has been calculated basis some algorithm at the back end. Right? So that helps in preserving interpretability. Clustering features, again, a multicollinearity, reducing multicollinearity, reducing the dimension space helps you in putting those variables in single clusters where all the variables that in a form of particular cluster are really correlated to each other and not really with the other cluster. So you could pick up probably one or a top two variables out of those clusters, which can explain the model well, not just by having all 200 or 300 variables. Now, with these machine learning models coming up, the complexities of building a model has increased. And that's why the newer features that have come up for reducing your variables. You know, you would have heard about PCA. The newer, you know, algorithms that are now available is a robust PCA. The difference is predominantly in the side of robust PCA is basically prone to the outliers that are present in your variables. If you have a lot of outliers in your variables, the PCA will form an orthogonal component, but that will not be as accurate as you will use that when you will end up using a robust PCA. There are other methods that are available, nonlinear techniques like autoencoders, which predominantly works on the neural network phenomena. It essentially helps, so we are using neural networks to really reduce the number of variables, identifying the better variables, again for reducing your multicollinearity in your data set. SVD, singular value decomposition, again one of the better ways of, you know, reducing multicollinearity. But the drawback, if I can call about for these algorithms, would be you lose the interpretability, because there is a newer variable that gets created out of from those, you know, original variables that you have. So that's the, you know, side, you know, disadvantage of using these algorithms. The other topic, you know, I told about, we'll talk about machine learning models being not used, or still organizations still face some resistance in using machine learning models because they are not easily interpreted. Now, can we really make them interpreted? Is there a way we can use them? Is there a way, can I explain those models to the business, which variables are driving a particular prediction, which variable is, you know, positively driving it, which variables in, you know, inversely driving it? Can we get onto those, you know, findings? The answer, fortunately, is yes. Now, how many of you heard about a concept called ELI5? Great. Now, this essentially stands for explain like I am 5. So, you build a model, not literally, right? A 5-year-old child cannot just understand a machine learning model. So, not literally, but you would be able to explain these models like to a 5-year-old child. So, that's where these concepts come from. And all the, you know, the algorithms that I talk about in my next slide is predominantly under this ELI5. Post-modeling diagnostics. Line charts, partial dependence charts, the latest one, you know, I was reading about is ice plots. I'll talk about relative importance of the variables, etc., etc. Line charts typically stands for local interpretation, model agnostic explanations. As you would say, the first word is L, which stands for local. So, the interpretation of these models is not global phenomena, it's a local explanation, which means that any instance that you would want to see why a particular prediction has happened in your data set or in a test data set or in a training data set, you would rather perturb those data points for which you want to justify a particular prediction. You would create, you know, n number of samples around it. You build that model, the same machine learning model, give those weightages of those newly formed data set and run up probably a linear regression model or maybe a decision tree model. Now, the output, the dependent variable forms there is becomes the probabilities that were formed or a prediction that has happened using a machine learning model. So that becomes your dependent variable here. Now, this way you will be able to at least explain why a particular instance of what you have predicted is really, what are the drivers really behind it. Now, if you look at the chart on the line charts, it's the idea was for, you know, building this model is to whether there will be a shot made by a player or not, right? The actual model says zero, which means a shot will not be made. But when I'm running a low line model on the model that has been developed by a machine learning model, the probability is very high, which is 0.83, which means I am picking up an instance where it says the model will be very high. The prediction is very high in terms of a yes, but not at the global level. So what, how will you use it is you will go back and see what are the drivers that are, you know, driving this particular prediction. So if the short style is chunk and your short area is centered, there's a high chance that you'll be able to make a shot. So you go back and see what is happening behind these variables, what is the values that are created. And you, what you'll end up doing is you'll run multiple iterations of various instances of your model, and finally you'll be able to give an explanation as to why really a particular instance is predicting a particular outcome. That forms a part of my LIME explanations. Another post-modeling diagnostic is a partial dependence. What this does is it picks up a variable, right, and picks up all the values of that variable. For each value of the variable, it runs a model on the other values that are present for other attributes. The outcome that it gets, it averages them out and gives a final prediction for that particular instance. Now again, this is not a local phenomenon, it's a global phenomenon. So it might happen that a one variable that you would run a partial dependence plot says that your variable is not at all correlated with the particular prediction because it has averaged out, right? One prediction could be saying a probability of, let's say, 0.51, the other says minus 0.51, or not a minus, 0.49. So it averages out. So there are very high chances that your correlation really comes down to zero. Now to counter this, there's another method of doing a post-modeling diagnostic is a ICE plots, individual conditional expectancies. This overcomes this deficiency, if I can call that, of partial dependence. It doesn't really get to an averages of the prediction that has happened, but it nails down at an observation level. So at an observation level or at a cluster level, it will tell you why a particular prediction has been made. That's the other part. Fourth one is relatively simple, variable importance. I think most of you would know it. Relative importance, you know, it creates an importance of the variable basis, the errors that have been reduced in the next steps. By introducing another variable, if the error reduces, that how much the variable error reduces is what really gives you a variable importance. Relative importance, generally we look at relative importance. I personally look at relative importance because it brings me on a particular scale from a 0 to 1, right? It doesn't go from an, so I don't know how to compare 81 versus 45, right? I don't have a benchmark. What relative importance will help me is really bring this to 1, and the other variables will, and other values will revolve around this 81. So now I know this is half of this, right? Currently you don't see it's half of it. So that's it, that is how you will be able to judge, you know, which is your better variables in terms of prediction. What do we need to do to make some variables better in terms of interpreting a particular instance? Can I take the questions later on, please, once the time lies? Now, from a SAS perspective, how do we make this possible? Right? I talked a lot theoretical concepts, you know, partial dependence charts, the line charts, ICE plots. How do we make this possible? Is an evolutionary transformation, if I can call that, is of SAS, which is what we are naming it as SAS VIA. Now, the reason I say it's an evolutionary transformation, I'm going to highlight in my next couple of slides, but I'm assuming no one is dozing off. So I'm going to play a very high voltage video to introduce SAS VIA in the room. Oh, is there a sound band? Excuse me. Sound? Not really? think SaaS via an open platform. Again, the reason I'm saying it open is because it is predominantly meant to do any kind of analytics that you would want to do with a single platform, right? Be it visualization, be it statistical modeling, machine learning, deep learnings, optimization, forecasting, everything happens in a single platform, which is SaaS via. Yes, next slide talks about why it is open. From the left hand side, you could see, you know, it can ingest data from any sources, be it in stream, be it Hadoop, or be it in your, you know, in-premise databases. On the bottom side, you could see an Amazon, Azure, GCP, OpenStack. So you host your applications on any of the clouds, it's supported. Even in supported on your on-premise also. On the right hand side, you would see R and Python, you know, the APIs. So in that sense, we are open to an open source world. Now we realize, you know, there's a power in the R and Python. So why not our customers end up using what they want to use? So you choose the language of your own choice. You choose which cloud you want to get on. You choose the type of data that you want to ingest in. We'll help you get onto that journey. That's essentially the message that I'm going to take. Embracing and extending open source is what this SaaS Fi really accomplishes for you. Covering, just picking up some few, you know, snapshots as to how it is really an open environment. Language of your choice, you remain on SaaS, you remain on Python, you remain on R, but you still be able to use, you know, SaaS at the back end to run your processes. So at a leadership level, probably, you know, the leaders will not be bothered about whether I need to hire a SaaS guy, I need to hire a Python or an R guy. You know, what they are really matters is the business problem getting really solved. So this is where you'll end up using any language of your choice. SaaS is on GitHub, which means the codes of running, you know, any algorithm, predominantly most algorithms are now available on GitHub. So go ahead, pick up the codes, run it in SaaS, and you'll be able to, you know, start using analytics without really starting it from scratch of building a models right from the scratch. REST APIs, yes, the model that gets built up can be transferred into a REST APIs, which can help you in consuming the applications or the models that you have developed in your downstream applications. Third part is run native models in SaaS. You write your native programs, which is written in Python or written in R. You'd be able to bring them in SaaS, compare those models, whichever gives the best performance in terms of the statistics that you want to evaluate. Go ahead, evaluate that, and you'll be able to consume the models, whichever that gives you a better, you know, accuracy. Support it on ONNX formats. If the model is getting built on any of the other platforms, be it Amazon, be it any open source, R or Python, we are supported on the ONNX format. So we can read the ONNX files also, which means the area of your playing from a practitioner's point of view is really eased up, is really massive, and this is where we can help the practitioners really to build an analytics ecosystem in an organization. This is a very late entry to the slide, to the deck. The reason this was a late entry is because I was on the SaaS booth today and there are a lot of questions that were coming up as to are we doing image analytics, are we doing video analytics or not, are we in the computer vision space or not. So just to give you a message, with SaaS via machine learning, deep learning, natural language processing, and of course the supporting technologies are all available. I'm not going to dwell too much on it. I have been mandated not to make it a more of a marketing pitch, but this was just to let the group know, because I have got a lot of queries today. So this is just to let the group know that, you know, all these are possible in various algorithms that are present in SaaS. Okay. Use case, the demo. It's a default prediction use case that I'm going to bring today. I could have, I wanted to bring on the video analytics one, but I didn't have the GPUs really to work upon with today. So I brought on this. Miss Sarah is an analytics consultant. You know, she works with a bank. It was given to her that, you know, you build a model where you're trying to predict whether a customer will default or not. She doesn't have any knowledge of how to build a multivariate models. So maybe let's just try to help Miss Sarah in helping her assignment complete. Let the fun begin then. I'm picking up a data. I think I talked about the important part is to really understand what's happening in the data, which is the pre-modeling steps, right? Let me see how my data looks like. Some customer ID is being present, durations in months, purpose credit taken, years at employment, marital status, other debt indicators. I've got some 5 missing values in my age, so I really need to, you know, have my data complete before I proceed with any modeling techniques. Let me do some. I think I'm short on time, but let me just go back. Now there are auto ML techniques that, you know, that comes up with. So, you know, as a first cut, you will get a particular models built on a lot of feature engineering exercises and a lot of machine learning models being used with an auto ML technique. But of course, as a data scientist, as a practitioner, you would still want to, you know, refine those models which have come automatically from the tool. So you would still get those flexibility in terms of you really being building a model on top of what an auto ML functionality is offering from the tool. Just getting the data set for my predictive modeling exercise, and that's it. Let me just define what my target variable is. So default on payment is my target variable. So I'll change that to target. Now, you know, I'll do some bit of data mining activities. I knew there were some, you know, 5 observations that were missing. And I knew once I saw the data was skewed a bit. So let me just do a bit of an outlier treatment also. Yes, there are techniques where you really don't need imputations or outlier treatment using the WAE approaches. I'm sure many of you would have used it. You can still use them, but I'm just running through the processes of the way I feel, you know, I'm just running it. But of course, you're free to use WAE approaches. Typically started with in the risk analytics space in the banking industries, but, you know, a lot of marketing analytics teams are also using WAE approaches because it simply avoids you, it simply helps you in not really running through the imputations, outlier treatments, and just helps you in defining a better predictive models. You don't really need to do a lot of variable reduction techniques also, because automatically the IV values, the information values also comes up with. But right now I'm just going ahead with the missing values, the outlier treatments, some bit of a feature engineering, and then I'm going to build models. You have the options of picking off, choosing and defining a particular imputations for all different variables. Currently I have just one variable which has 5 misses. Of course, in a practical scenario where you really end up building models, you don't get data in this neat and clean form. I am agreeing with you, because I worked a lot on really messy data sets. But given the time constraint that I have, I'm just picking up and showing the ML techniques and how to really deploy those models. So just building a pipeline of the projects as to how I see. Let this be the way it is. Transformations. Just pick up the best. Just adding up some models. Now, ideally, the way I would really like to, you know, work upon when I really built a model is really run multiple iterations just for one algorithm, and then running multiple iterations for another algorithm. So it's really, for me, it would be really an M cross N matrix. For the sake of time, I'm doing a very simplistic way of building a model, but of course this can be really, really complex as to, you know, how you really come upon getting the best iteration for your models. Let's pick up a statistical model. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to run an auto-tuning option for one of these models, gradient boosting or a random forest, where I'm not going to define, for example, for a random forest, I'm not going to bother about what should be the number of variables to start with, what should be the number of observations to start with, what should be the number of trees to start with. Let the model run, give me the best, you know, results, and then I'll fine-tune those hyperparameters. I'll for one modeling algorithm, for example, a gradient boosting, I'll do some changes to myself, building those hyperparameters, run a logistic, maybe a stepwise with some significant values of alpha of 0.5 or 0.05, and then we'll see how the results look like. Me change for a random forest. Trees, let number of trees be 100. Generally, you would start with a 60% of an out of bag sample with a random forest, and thumb rule being a square root of n of the number of variables that are present. That's a thumb rule, of course, you know, doesn't really always fits. So let me just start with 5 here, because I have around 25 odd variables, 25, 26 odd variables. Let my gradient boost, was that GLM? No. GLM will not run, its classification technique. I'm just running this on auto-tuning, so I'm not worried about the L1 regularization, L2 regularizations, the number of branches, the number of, you know, number of optimal number of observations in a particular node. So I'm not worried about all those now. I'm going to click this button and run this model now. It's going to take some time. In the meanwhile, let me also, you know, show you how you could actually build up an open source model by running SAS. Okay. This is a use case that I had talked today to a few of my customers today in terms of in the image analytics space, right? And this is the one we did for one of the governments in India, where the use case was really the government wanted to identify on a particular highway, is there any two-wheeler or a three-wheeler that is running, because that highway was just meant for a four-wheeler vehicles. So you are not the a three-wheeler, an auto or a scooter was not allowed to run because it's a very high speed zone. Now the task was to really using the images that the cameras that being deployed, how do we see whether there's a two-wheeler or three-wheeler being driven out there. Now, if you see, there's a package called SWAT. Again, this is available on GitHub, but this is being developed by SAS, which really helps you in using SAS along with an open source. So if you don't run SWAT, you'll not be able to use the integration tech. It's really an integration technology between SAS and open source. But you know, with SAS, you'll get this and you'll be able to integrate with the open source. And you would continue writing, as I said, you know, you continue writing your codes in Jupyter as you would want, as you would run in a native, you know, Python world. Some of the advantages that come over here, but I'm not going to talk about, because I just want to show you. The images, analytics, video cases being solved by using open source and SAS for one of those customers. And we are using a VGG16 model to be able to, you know, detect whether the particular image is a two-wheeler or a three-wheeler or four-wheeler. This is almost run, just writing 30 seconds more. Okay. Now, how do I, if assumingly, you know, we have passed the validation test, we have passed, you know, the model which I have chosen is really to be used for deployment purposes. How do I really know, how do I really consume those models, the deployment aspect that I talked about? So the product really gives you a scoring API, which can be then consumed in your downstream applications. Now I'm going to, you know, show as a last step of the demo as to how do I call a particular model from my downstream applications. It could be a mobile app, it could be a website, you know, it could be your own application that you would have developed. So this is an application that was developed by a developer in SAS, not really to do with a data scientist per se, it's more of a development exercise, developer exercise rather, where somebody who's a more of a hands-on coder will develop, you know, these kind of applications. But once these applications are developed, you will be able to, you know, communicate with these downstream applications. So what really you need to do is very quickly, whatever the downstream application is and wherever your server is, they needs to authenticate that, you know, this machine can really talk to my SAS file, because they need to authenticate and validate that particular downstream application. So these are the steps you will need to take before this really gets into a driving mode. So this gives me all the models that were built on SAS while I'm remaining on my downstream applications. And you pass on these, you know, values. Let me just do that. So once you pass out these parameters, for example, I'm passing age as 35. I think I'm shooting time, but that should be over now. What you really get is, once you fill up all this information, I know there are a lot of variables. I really don't want to see all my variables in my final model. Yes, I would really want to stick around 5 or 6, 30 seconds more. Yes. I would really stick with 5 or 6 models in my final model basis the significance criteria. Once you submit the result, the scores of that particular customer being defaulted or whatever your business problem is comes down on your web application or on your downstream applications. So a person sitting really in the field, working in a field, working in any downstream application, doesn't really bothered about what is happening in as an analytical engine. He'll still be able to use SAS for your live scoring of your models. Thank you. I think this is what I wanted to cover today. I know we have a question. I'll take it. Thank you very much. Thanks. Bye.